So, I want to tell you guys a little bit about myself. If you're wondering who this guy is standing up here, I've been here at New Life for a very long time. I've been here since I was 2, and I was raised up in this, and some amazing leaders have come into my life along the way, and I just want to thank them and thank them for pouring into me. So my role here on Sunday mornings is production supervisor. Now that sounds really cool and it sounds really great, but I'll be honest with you, I don't really have that much responsibility here. So if you're wondering, man, why did they give so much responsibility to this 20-year-old guy at this church, just know that it's really not that big of a deal. So let me explain to you what I do here, on Sundays at least. So my role is to be the bridge and to fill in the gap between all the ministries and all the areas of production that go on Sunday morning. So for example, there's the music team, which I'm so thankful to be a part of. Can we give it up for the music team? They put in a lot of time. I'm so grateful to be a part of that team. From the music team to the production team, the young people running our cameras, to the people running the lights, to the people upstairs in our control room, switching the camera shots. Let's see if they're paying attention or not. Switch the shot. No, they're not even up there. They're not even paying attention. Switch it. I'm kidding. Maybe someone's not up there. But, there's Louie. Yeah, you know he's not doing his job. I'm kidding. So anyways, no matter what area it is in production, what my role is to be able to make sure everyone's on the same page and we're all communicating clearly to one another. And I'm still working on that. I'm still trying to figure out how to do a better job at that. So thank you for having a little grace on us in the process, because occasionally you'll see our screens go out, or you'll see, or you'll have some mic feeding back, but it's okay. It's okay, because this is a work in progress, and I'm thankful that God has allowed me to be a part of this process. So, yes. So, and like I told people last service, if you'd like to know more about me, you just got to check out my account on christianmingle.com. I'm kidding. I don't have an account. I'm kidding. Some of you guys I saw were pulling out your phones already looking me up. I saw that. But I don't actually have an account yet. One day. So I want to start with this. If you're searching for the kingdom of God, you don't have to search any longer, because God says that he has put his kingdom inside of you. You see, if you're waiting for your family to, you're waiting to see a change in your family, I'm telling you that the change is going to start with you. Once you realize that the kingdom of God is within you, and once you get the necessary steps to release that kingdom into your homes, into your schools, into your jobs, and into every person, every place that you encounter. So I could think of no better way to start this message out than going to God's word. You see, when I was younger and someone would be speaking or preaching on a stage, when they would go to the scripture, my mind would lose focus. I would start to check out. But it wasn't until about a few months ago when I had a conversation with Pastor Robert here, and this is what he told me, I'll never forget it. He said, God is going to take you and take this church to the next step whenever us as leaders start seeking his word. Because in here, you can find that God is speaking directly into your life. See, there are times when I'll read my Bible and I won't get anything out of it. It just seems like there are words on a page. But later in the day, I'll find myself in a situation or having a conversation with someone, God will remind me of what he spoke to me earlier in the day. And then I just am so amazed by how God can speak directly into our lives through his word. So if you're searching for a purpose in his plan, I'm pretty sure that you're going to find it if you dig into his word. So here we go. We're going to start the scripture. It should be on the screen. If you have a Bible, you can follow along with me. If not, it's okay. You can check it out on the screen if someone's up there running it, hopefully. So here it is. Ezekiel 36:27. This is the Good News translation. Very easy to understand. Very easy to read, which I like. So here it is. It says, I will put my spirit in you. You see, today we're talking about the kingdom of God within you. It says, I will put my spirit in you. and will see to it that you follow my laws and keep all the commands I have given you. You see, you can't receive a command, you can't hear a command unless you hear a voice. You can't hear God's plan for your life, his commands for your life, until you've heard his voice. And you see, we're taught at such an early age that the voice inside of us is simply our own conscience. But, and most of the time, that is the case. Studies show that we make an average of 35,000 decisions over the course of one day. And some of those, that's amazing. And some of those decisions are pretty simple, such as, what should I eat this morning? Which reminds me, I didn't eat anything this morning. Dang, I'm going to be hungry by the time third service comes along. But it's all right. Or simple decisions like, what should I wear to church today? Some of you guys, I can see, put a little more focus into that this morning than others. I'm kidding. I don't mean to judge you. I'm kidding. But some of the decisions we make are simple, like, should I go to church today? That's such a simple decision for me because I want to be here. Not only do I want to be here, I want to serve God while I'm here. And I hope that God puts that in your heart today. So check it out. God, it says in Ezekiel 36 that he has put his spirit in you. Even if you don't know God, you can hear his voice. And God's voice, out of the 35,000 decisions you make a day, God's voice is calling you to only make one. One out of 35,000, and that is to simply follow him. So check it out. I want to ask you guys a question, and this is the question that our Young Life group came across a few weeks back. If you're not sure what Young Life is, it's a group of young adults, and there's about 20 of us young adults and leaders who meet on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. in the student building. So if you're a young adult between the ages of 18 and 22, and you're looking for some group to be a part of, a family to belong to, and you're looking to have a deeper relationship with God, then I encourage you to check it out on Wednesday. This Wednesday, I will see you there. So this is the question that we came across. It's really one of those questions that doesn't have an easy answer. See, sometimes God gives us questions in life, and he doesn't give us the answer right away because he's wanting us to search for it. He's wanting us to find it in his word. So here's the question. Is it possible for someone to live their entire lives without realizing the existence of God? Is it possible for someone to live their whole life without even pondering the fact that there might be a God? The example we came across is, say I was raised as an atheist. Say my parents were atheists, and my brothers and sisters and everyone that played a part in raising me didn't believe that there was a God. That's the example we came up with. And when I thought of that and we asked that question, I didn't have the answer, but God had the answer. I just had to search for it. So here it is. This is Romans chapter 1, verse 20. Follow along with me if you can. Ever since God created the world, since the beginning of time, his invisible qualities, both his eternal power and his divine nature, have been clearly seen. They are perceived in the things that God has made. You see, ever since the beginning of time, we perceive his invisible qualities by the things he's made. Here it goes. It goes on to say, so those people have no excuse at all. Is it possible for someone to live their entire lives without realizing the existence of God? The answer is no. You see, the scripture says God's invisible qualities have been clearly seen. It doesn't say that his qualities might suggest that there is a God. It says no, they have been clearly seen, and there is no excuse for those people at all. How do we see his qualities? Through his eternal power and his divine nature. If you ask any of the men who went up to men's camp this last weekend, which, by the way, I want to show some honor to the men who put all that together. So can we give it up to the leaders? They spent a lot of time in planning and for men's camp. And I could tell you it was an excess, and they know it because God showed up. And God had an encounter with every man who went up there. I believe we have a photo to show you guys. We had over 60 men who decided to go to men's camp. There they are, right there. There they are. And the crazy thing about it is every single man in that picture had an encounter with God. Every single one of them. And I thank God for that. I was one of them. So I also want to give a shout out to the young men who decided to go to men's camp. Can we give it up for them? Because check it out. They didn't just go to men's camp to relax and have a good time and to be camping. They went up there with a servant's heart. They went up there and they served the older men by cleaning up after dinner and whatnot. And it's funny because I actually had a conversation with one of them after one of the meals, and they said, Donnie, they all call me Donnie for some reason. By the way, my name's Dylan, but you can call me Donnie, that's fine. Whatever you want to call me is cool. But he's like, Donnie, I saw something so disgusting in the bottom of that pot. It was the most disgusting thing I've ever seen in my life. I was like, what was it? He's all I can explain it as was like month-old oatmeal. I was like, dude, that's crazy because we didn't even eat oatmeal up while we were up here. So I still don't know what was in that pot, but I thank you, young man, for cleaning it because you were up there with a servant's heart, a servant's heart. That's what God is calling us to do, is to serve others. And those young men absolutely did that while they're up there. But if you ask any man who went to men's camp, I guarantee you, every single one of them would tell you that they were able to witness God's divine nature in those mountains. You see, when you see the massiveness of a redwood tree and you realize that it came and it all started from a tiny seed, you can't deny the fact that something greater than us created it. Someone greater than us created it. And I want to share an interesting fact about those trees. Some of you guys might have heard this up at men's camp. Pastor Manuel shared it. But before I share this fact, I want you to know that the same creator that designed those trees designed you. The same creator who saw his plan work out for those trees, that even though it started from a tiny seed, that might be where you're at right now. Your faith may be as small as a tiny seed, but the same creator who saw his plan work out for those trees is the same creator who's going to see his plan for your life work out. So I just want to encourage you with that. Check out this fact about these trees. You would think, and I believe there's a picture up here that we can show you, you would think that a 350-foot tall tree would need a root system that stretches deep into the ground and is just simply holding on for dear life. You would think that. But can you guys throw that picture up there real quick? If you notice in the picture, there is a man standing up there near the bottom of the tree. And he looks very tiny compared to that tree. But I'm guessing that he's probably, about 5-6 feet tall. He doesn't look like he looks like a normal guy. The crazy fact about these redwood trees is that their root system only goes about 5 to 6 feet under the ground. So if you take that guy and you put his head under the tree, that is how deep those roots go. So you might be asking yourself, well, how does a tree stand so tall for so long? You see, what these trees' roots lack in depth, they make up for it in how wide they stretch out. The roots in these trees can stretch outwards up to 100 feet to the left, the right, and front, and back of it. So when you see a redwood tree standing, and you see another one 10 feet from the left of it and 10 feet on the right of it, you must imagine that eventually their root systems are going to cross paths. And once they cross paths, they start intertwining with one another, and they start to reinforce the tree on the left and the right of it. You see, the only reason these trees can stand so tall for so long is because they're not doing it alone. You see, God never intended on his creations to be standing alone. From the beginning of time, when God created the world and everything in it, after he created the galaxies and he created the first man named Adam, not the first man named Adam, but the first man, and he breathed the breath of life into him, God stepped back and he observed what he had created. But he noticed one thing was missing. he noticed that the image of himself was incomplete. Check it out if you can follow along with me. It should be up here on the screen. It's Genesis 2:18. It says, "The Lord God said, 'It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a suitable companion to help him.'" And now I'm not up here to talk to you about how us men just need a good woman in our life and we'll find happiness, because honestly, I don't have a whole lot of experience in that area to tell you guys that. And if you're wondering, I'm not looking to get experience in that. So tell your kids, tell your wives that I'm not available right now. I'm sorry. You got a list. That's funny. But anyways, in that moment when God created a companion for mankind, the image of God was not made complete with the creation of a woman, but it was made complete with the creation of relationships. You see, here at New Life, we place relationships at a high value. When we look at our lives, we realize that the people around us are going to make the most impact in our lives. The people we surround ourselves will make the most impact in our lives. In Proverbs 13:20, it says, "Become wise by walking with the wise. Hang out with fools and watch your life fall to pieces." And it's funny how for a lot of us, the most time that we spend with people are the ones who are leading us to a life that is going to fall to pieces. You see, the way that I was taught that wise saying or that wise scripture in the Bible was, the way I was taught was from, was the person who taught me was Pastor Louis. Pastor Louis taught me this, and I cannot go through this whole message without giving it up for Louis, because thank you, because I would not be here, I would not be up here right now if it weren't for him. And not only did he call out God's plan for my life, the plan that was in me, not only did he call it out, but he called out a boldness in me. It was in there. It was just a matter of me needing someone to call it out in me, and God placed him in my life to do that. And I hope that you guys can find someone who can do the same for you. So, but the way he taught me this was, show me your friends and I'll show you your future. You guys have heard that before, right? You see, at New Life, we realize that the people around us will determine where God can take us. Even if you look at our values, our first two values are, we are a church for anyone and we have a place for everyone. How can you show someone that this is the place for them if you don't show them that you care about them? You see, that is the whole reason why we're here, is to show each other that we care about one another and we lift each other up. Our sixth value says that we is greater than me. At New Life, we believe we is greater than me. We are not meant to do this alone. So just as God took a step back and observed his creation and realized we're not meant to do this alone, here at New Life, we realize the same. You see, God's kingdom is within us. But oftentimes, we surround ourselves with people who try to tell us otherwise. But once you start surrounding yourself with people who will speak life into you and encourage you and call out the kingdom inside of you, you will begin to experience God's presence and have more encounters with him throughout your day. You see, God is wanting you to release the kingdom inside of you, and it makes it so much easier when you surround yourself with people who will help you do that. So I encourage you that you guys are in a good place right now. Give it up for yourselves for deciding to join us today. So I'm going to give you four steps. I'm going to finish with this. We're almost done, actually. I'm going to give you four steps to experiencing God's presence, not only while you're at church, but everywhere you go. You can also think of this as four steps on how to release the kingdom of God that is within you. So check it out. If you're taking notes, please write these down. It's one thing Pastor Dave taught me and has taught some of you guys, is that the enemy can steal your thoughts, but he can't steal your notes. So please, you can't. And if he does steal your notes, then he is really impressive. I'm kidding. Sorry. Anyways, this is step one, okay? If you're taking notes, please write this down. This is step one. It says, it is to be accepted. be accepted into the family of God. That is the first step. And if you're wondering, well, how can I want so desperately to be in and a part of a family, maybe you're even thinking, I want to be involved in a family here at New Life, but you might be asking yourself, how do I do that? Check it out. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 through 10, it says, if you confess that Jesus is Lord and believe that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is by our faith that we are put right with God. It is by our confession that we are saved. If we speak with our own words, you don't even have to say it out loud. It doesn't say you have to say it out loud. Even if you just say it in your head that Jesus, you are Lord, and I believe that you raised for the dead and that I am saved because of it. You don't even have to say it out loud. If you just believe that and say that in your head, then you can be saved and you can be accepted into the family of God. In a little bit, God is going to give you the opportunity to take a step. And it may be step one. You may be ready for step four. But wherever you're at today, I want you to know that God is speaking to you and is calling you to take a step wherever you're at. The last part of that says, for it is by our faith that we are put right with God. It is by our confession that we are saved. So check it out. This is step two. It says to be aware. Step two to experiencing God's presence, step two to releasing the kingdom of God within you is to be aware. Be aware that God's presence is everywhere. In Jeremiah 23:24, it says, God says, no one can hide where I cannot see them. Do you not know that I'm everywhere in heaven and earth? You don't have to be in a holy place like a church to experience God's presence. Be aware that his presence is everywhere and that it is within you. So wherever you go, he goes. The third step is to be active. Be actively seeking God's presence. Be actively seeking God's presence. I'm going to take it a step further. Boldly seek God's presence. It's easy while we're here at church around people who love God and are doing it with us, but it becomes difficult when we step outside these doors. Be active. Actively seek God's presence. And the fourth and final step, we're going to finish with this, is to be alert. Be alert to God's voice. You see, the voice of God is within you, but if you're not careful, you just might miss what he's trying to tell you. This is the last scripture I'm going to read today, and it's probably my favorite. It's 1 Kings 19, chapter 19, verse 11 through 12. This is God speaking to Elijah, one of his prophets. And what a prophet is someone who can hear God's voice and speaks it into people's lives. This is what God said to him. He said, go out and stand before me on top of the mountain, the Lord said to him. Then the Lord passed by and sent a furious wind that split the hills and shattered the rocks. But check it out. It says, the Lord was not in the wind. Sometimes there will be a storm that comes into our life, and we think that it's God's way of punishing us. But it says, God, the Lord, was not in the wind. It goes on to say, the wind stopped blowing, and then there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, there was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. God might be putting you through the fire right now, but it says, you know what? He's not in that to harm you. He's not in that to harm you. He's just wanting to get your attention. And that's the only way he can do it, is by giving you this storm in your life. All he wants is your attention. And then it goes on to say, after the fire, there was the soft whisper of a voice. If we are not alert to God's voice that's within us, we just might miss it. Sometimes we're wanting God to shout out our name. We want God to just make it obvious to us that he's speaking to us. But you see, if God's having to shout out your name, then the only explanation for why he has to do that is because you're far from him. And I don't know about you guys. I don't know if you've ever been in a place where you've been far from God. I have. But when we're far from God, that's when depression can take over. That's when anger can start getting the best of us. That's when we start losing hope that God actually does have a plan for us. When we're far from God, then he has to shout out our name. And sometimes when he has to shout out our name, oh man, he sends the storm to get our attention, and it sucks. It sucks sometimes, but it's his only way of getting our attention. So I encourage you to be alert to the soft whisper of his voice that is speaking to you today. If we're not being alert to God's voice, then we just might miss an encounter with him that will change our lives forever. I want to finish with this. Your life won't start changing until you experience God's presence and you experience his love. It's a life-changing love, a love that can't be compared to anything else. Next week is Father's Day, and for some of you guys, there has been a void inside of you, and you've been trying to fill that void with a love from somebody, from someone else. Maybe you've been trying to seek your father's approval. Maybe some of you guys in here have lost someone, have lost a kid. You see, you've been trying to fill that void, that love that's missing, with another love from another person. But the only person who can fill that void in your life is Jesus. Once you experience his love, your life will start changing. In Acts 1:8, it says, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will be filled with power, and you will be witnesses for me, your God. Some of you are having a hard time proclaiming the name of Jesus in your jobs, in your family. Some of you are having a hard time telling people about the good news. I struggle with it. I struggle with it daily. I don't know why. I know why. It's because there's a fear. There's a fear to proclaim God's name in a dark world. Sometimes we want to cover the light that is within us because we just want to fit in to the dark world that we're in. You see, but in Acts 8 it says, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you'll be filled with power. You'll be able to break those chains, the fear that's been holding you back. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will be filled with power, and you will be witnesses for me, your God. You won't be ashamed of the gospel.